Those who do miracles in my name, get away from me.
Some of them.
I don't know. I'm not a Christian. I'm a Muslim. He will talk it to the Christian. Get away from me.
He's going
to
say
Jesus will be saying to the Christian, get away from me. Get away from me.
Some of them.
I don't know. That's not my problem. That's not my problem. What I know, he will say to the Christians, get away from me. And you believe that.
Some of the Christians.
You believe that. He will say to the Muslims, he will say to the Jews, he will say to the Christians, get away from me. Jesus, when he comes on the second time, he will say to the Christians, get away from me, because I never knew you, get away from me. That's not my problem.
Let him answer that though. Let him answer that.
We know that.
The fake
one. Can you answer that?
Yeah.
Who can answer that?
The fake one. So the fake Christians who are saying, hallelujah, I do it in Jesus' name, man.
Yeah, okay.
Do it in Jesus' name. They're fake. Yeah. They're fake. And Jesus is going to say, I never knew you. Jesus, the Lord, is going to say, I know you are fake. You're doing all these miracles and all these crazy stuff. Some of them were doing horrible, evil. Some of them do it today. But some Christians, do you know what they do?
I disagree.
Miracles happen today. God can still do miracles today.
No.
But through the true ones, the fake ones, show you a miracle. Okay, I'll stop it raining. I've done it.
No, wait.
Just stop the rain.
You need a psychiatrist. You need a good psychiatrist.
Jesus, when he said that.
Queen Mary.
Yes.
Why Queen Mary?
Why you
Queen Mary?
Why you
missing? You can trust God with the air you breathe.
When Jesus says,
you want me to answer why he was to get away from me?
No.
Do you know why? Do you know the reason?
He needs an answer.
Do you know the reason?
Can you do a proper
because
answer?
Because they're fake.
Fake Christians.
They say hallelujah. We do miracles.
He's lying.
But they're fake.
Okay, that's the one answer. That's
you
one
have
answer.
The true, and you have the fake.
Read the scripture.
Okay, let's get another answer now.
The real one,
read the scripture.
And then you get the fake one.
Get away from
see
me,
Jesus.
I never knew
Jesus
you
in the last days.
What
so
did he
easy.
Say that? What's the context, the exegesis of that, Brogan?
Okay.
This is what I want to know.
I tell you what, yeah? Jesus Christ.
Repeat it again. Repeat yeah. your point again.
Yeah, so my point is, why will Jesus Christ, on his second coming, he will say to the Christ, he will say to those who will call him Lord, Lord. Those who will say, Lord, Lord, then do we do mighty miracles in your name? That he will say, get away from me. He called a name. He called them some nasty name. And they said, I didn't know you. All right? Why will he say that? Because, okay, I will give an answer on the Islamic.
You asking and giving an answer.
Yeah, I'll give an answer because there's no point.
At
the same time, yes.
All right, so you already have an answer for your question?
Yeah, but I will answer it.
You want an answer or you already have an answer?
Do you want to answer it?
Sorry?
Do you want to answer
it? No, my brother, he will answer
you
it.
You want to answer it?
Yes.
Okay.
So that's your argument, but can I ask you, I will answer that, but do you know where that's found?
Where is it found?
Do you know where that's found?
It's from the scripture.
Yeah, which gospel, which chapter?
I can't remember.
Okay, so that's the problem. All you've done, all due respect, and we see this as a common finger speakers corner, you've heard an argument somewhere online, you think...
I read it in the Bible. It's in the Bible. Even if it's...
Wait.
So you think that applies to Christians, but in reality it doesn't. What does it apply to? And you said that Jesus would say, those who say, Lord, Lord, we did this in your name, we did that in your name, this, that and the other, okay? Jesus says, get away from me, I never knew you. Why? Because they were workers of iniquity. They were lawless. So what does it mean? They broke commandments. They weren't really following Christ. But it wasn't because, as you're trying to say, those calling him Lord, it was because they was calling him Lord in a false way. They was calling him Lord, but at the same time not living like he was really Lord. And that same gospel you're referring to, Matthew chapter 7, okay, if you continue to read Matthew, Jesus is actually called Lord a multiple amount of times, and he accepts that. Why? So the context is, at times he accepts people calling him Lord because they genuinely follow him as Lord. Other times he rejects them calling him Lord because they're not really following him as Lord. That's the context. Now, before you give an argument, I think you should actually go away and read this passage, because you're simply, all due respect, regurgitating a script you've heard somewhere, because you couldn't even tell me where to find it.
No. Okay, whatever.
Are you satisfied with the answer?
I'm not satisfied, obviously.
Why?
I'm not satisfied.
Explain to him why.
Because whatever he's explained, that's his own explanation of the passage.
That's his own explanation.
Explanation, okay. Interpretation of the passage.
Man, was that your own explanation of the passage? He's claiming that was your own explanation of the passage.
Passage. Would you like to go there?
Okay. Let's get the evidence. Let's fact check.
because that same gospel you're using, like I said, there is a context to those who are calling him Lord, Lord. Because, 1 second. Because those who call him Lord, Lord there.
We believe you.
Thank you. I'm glad you believe me. But no, the gentleman doesn't.
So those
who are calling him Lord, Lord, okay, you're right, they are calling him Lord. But that's not referring to Christians as a kind of a blanket statement. Where are you going? Okay. So your argument is ultimately, he's saying that because they're Christians and they're calling him Lord. It's not because they're calling him Lord. That's not why he's saying, get away from me, I never knew you. He's saying, get away from me, I never knew you, because they were false believers. They weren't genuinely following him. And how do we know that? Because he said, you lawless people, you don't follow the law. You are workers of iniquity. Let's go to the passage.
John chapter 3. That's what he said. Believe.
Sorry, my hands are freezing.
You believe in the Father?
Go ahead, continue what you're saying. I'll find the passage for you.
How's everybody here, though? Yeah, we're here in the school and our family.
It's raining.
Some of the atheists are coming to speak as well. What's happening, buddy? You're late, bro. Who won? Arsenal or?
I was to hold you over Ben's head.
What was I going to say? It's okay, yeah?
Yeah.
All right, that's fine. All right, cool. So Ben, what's happening?
Following the passage.
Okay. So we're going to find the passage where...
So Matthew 7, 21. Okay, so the context is this. What's he saying?
And
let's bear this in mind. The whole of Matthew's gospel depicts Jesus as being divine. Okay, so they're not, as I said already, then he's not pushing them away because they're calling him Lord, because that's what you tried to tell the man there. You tried to say they're calling him Lord, Lord, so then he's going to tell them, go away.
That's not exactly what I said. Listen.
You can pick up after.
Okay, go on. Yeah.
So from my understanding, your argument was, because they're calling him Lord, Lord, then he will push them away. That's not why. If you read Matthew 7, 21, it actually says this. Not everyone who calls me Lord, okay? So not people who call me Lord in general, but not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father. Now, you as a Muslim cannot believe any of that, because you as a Muslim cannot believe that some people who will call Christ Lord, okay, you can't believe that will be accepted by Christ, and you also can't believe that Christ referred to God as his own Father. You can't believe any of that, okay? So all due respect, you are arbitrarily picking a passage here you think fits with Islamic theology, when in reality it doesn't, my friends. If you continue to read, on that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord. One second, on the last day. Okay. On the day of judgment. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, didn't we prophesy in your name, drive out demons in your name? So, and bear in mind, you can't believe, to start with, that people can, you as a Muslim cannot believe that anyone will cast out demons in the name of Christ.
One second.
So this passage, So as a Muslim,
you come from a worldview, don't you?
As a Muslim, you're using Matthew 7 to make an argument. I'm saying Matthew 7, as a Muslim, you can't believe.
Okay, can I say something? Okay, he just read the scripture, but he just read it, all right? So the fact is that we just say he just read the scripture. What the scripture says that on the last day, many will come to me and call me, did we not do a miracle and cast out demons in your name? All right? So the fact that people are doing this in the name of Jesus, believing that it's him that will, through his power, he will give that miracle. The miracle will be done in his name. And Jesus Christ in his day, he didn't teach that. Listen. We're talking. I listen to you, right? I listen to you. So what Jesus Christ is trying to say is that I didn't teach you that to say you will cast out demons in my name. All right. So what he said is that Jesus himself, whenever he needs something, he prays to God. He prays to his Father, and his father answers. Yeah, and his Father answers his prayer. Do you know what I mean? His father.
Your first question was it answered or was it wasn't?
It wasn't answered.
Now you're moving to the incarnation.
No. Well, I'm trying to explain something. I'm trying to explain something. All right. I'm trying to explain. All right.
Come on, because then what was the question?
So,
what was the question?
In the end times.
Yeah.
Wait. That's it. You try to say my belief. I believe. I'll tell you my belief. You were talking about. Sorry. You were talking about my belief. Yeah. I'll tell you my belief. I believe that Jesus is the mightiest prophet of God, and he can do any miracles in the name of God. So as he said, I cast out devil with the finger of God. All right, listen.
So ultimately, your argument really is that Jesus would never accept anyone calling him Lord in the first place. Because Matthew 7. No, stop.
I didn't finish. Because the word Lord, the word Lord can be used. We know that. The print of Lord.
Wait. What does the word Lord mean?
Say that again?
What does the word Lord mean?
It depends how you take it.
No, the word Lord means owner.
That's why I say it depends how you take it.
It means owner.
If I say my Lord.
Yeah, it means owner.
I can say the queen my Lord, but she's not the owner.
The queen is not.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. It depends how you use the word Lord. So that's why I say it depends how you use it. What is what you're thinking? No, it doesn't have. In the English language, it means owner. Yes, but if you go to the English language of the judge, you say my Lord. It doesn't mean the judge.
Right, he wants to respond now.
It doesn't mean the judge owned you. Doesn't mean.
All right, cool.
No. I'm trying to explain something to you.
Okay, we got the combo. That's right.
No, I can teach you, but the word Lord, you got it wrong.
Right, let's.
You got it wrong.
Okay, cool. Go back.
Sorry, can I respond? Okay, so if your argument is that in Matthew 7, Jesus wouldn't accept people calling him Lord in that context as being the Lord God, okay, the problem is, if you continue to read Matthew, time and time again, Jesus is called Lord and he accepts it. For example, he even calls himself in Matthew chapter 12, he says the Son of Man, which is actually referring back to Daniel 7, which is actually a divine title. But in Matthew chapter 12, he says the Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath. Now, who sets up the Sabbath? God sets up the Sabbath. So when Jesus says, I am the Lord of the Sabbath, he's saying, I am God.
For me, that one, you see, the word you just made a conclusion.
No, but hold on. If he's going to say he's the Lord of the Sabbath, hold on. If he's going to say he's the Lord of the Sabbath, who created the Sabbath? Logically, think. Who's the one who brought forth the Sabbath? In the Bible, who brought forth the Sabbath?
Who established the Sabbath? Who established the Sabbath? God.
I don't know.
Okay.
Yes,
okay. According to the Bible, God himself established the Sabbath. So when Jesus uses this term, I am Lord of the Sabbath, he's saying, I am God. If a prophet, if Jesus was just a prophet, he could not say,
I don't know which language I'm speaking, but I am Lord of the Sabbath, I am God. For me, it's too different.
No.
It's too
different. Who is Lord of the Sabbath?
Lord of the Sabbath. Lord of the Sabbath, I am God. If he is
Lord of the Sabbath, so it would be God.
It's a different, two different statements.
It's not hard, is it?
I am God.
You're just learning because you haven't got an argument.
It's two different. It's two different statements. I don't know which language. Are you speaking English?
Are
you speaking English?
I'm not in that verse. Who are you speaking about?
I'm not running away.
Hey, what's up?
Are you speaking English?
1 second.
I am Lord of the Sabbath. I am God.
Listen. Okay, let's use a hypothetical. If God says, I am the creator of that tree, okay? And then Jesus also says, I am the creator of that tree. It would logically follow Jesus is claiming to be God. So when God says in the Old Testament, when God says in the Old Testament, I have established the Sabbath, okay? And then Jesus says, I am Lord over the Sabbath, he's claiming to be God. No prophet could say that.
Okay, can I respond to that? Listening to this man, he's saying that, the example he gave, he used the word if. If is a if. Everybody knows what if is. You know what I mean? So, if doesn't mean nothing. So, but let's repeat his example that if God say, I am the Lord of that tree, can
of
you
Sabbath, of the Sabbath.
The example. Can you, I can't remember the example you said.
Yeah, let me go. Okay,
no, just the example, please. Just the example.
He's the Lord of the Sabbath.
No, just the example
of the tree.
Sorry?
The example of the tree.
One second.
Okay.
1 second. That was a hypothetical. We can't really reason from a hypothetical. I was using that as an analogy. It should go no further than an analogy.
No. An analogy, it means to understand. It means to understand.
Let
me finish. I didn't finish. I just asked you, but I didn't finish.
One more point, it's all yours.
Yeah, but
so
I didn't finish.
So when Jesus says, okay, I am Lord of the Sabbath, you're saying there's a lot of ifs. If he's this, if he's that. The problem is, it wasn't an if. He said, I am the Lord of the Sabbath. Not if I am.
No, you brought the word if. You said the word if. That's why I'm saying if doesn't mean nothing.
Okay. If kind of says you're doubting, can I respond?
Can I
ask me if I'm doubting.
With regard to
doubting.
Right, so why are you saying if?
I'm not doubting.
It was an analogy.
No, hold on.
This
is where we're playing semantics. We're playing semantics. When I said if Jesus said this, this is a claim to deity. And then when I point out it's not an if, he actually did say that, it's a claim to deity.
Okay.
That's a particular passage where Jesus is called Lord and he accepts it. But not only does he accept it, he uses that Lord title of himself and he places that Lord title over the Sabbath, which is a claim to be God.
That's from your own perspective, because if God is saying that I am God, your Lord, all right? That is
also the blessing. May the blessing of our Lord Jesus Christ and the fellowship of the Father.
That is clear. All right. But if Jesus is saying I am the Lord of the Sabbath, that doesn't mean that I am God. I am God is a very powerful statement
like
to be linked to. I am Lord of the Sabbath.
Would you like a clearer title?
If you have a clearer
okay.
one, yeah.
So when God says in Isaiah chapter 44 verse 6, I am the first and I am the last. Okay, that's God saying that. I am the first and I am the last, which means there is no one before me, there will be no one after me. It's a claim to be the eternal God. So God says that, yes? We agree that's God, yes?
Yeah.
Okay, but the problem is, for you, the problem is, Jesus in Revelation says, I am the first and I am the last. So that's a clearer statement where Jesus actually takes a divine title of God and applies that to himself.
So in the revelation,
who to be God?
No. Yeah, that's the point. Like in the revelation, we say I am the first and I am the last. In Isaiah, if you read the scripture, who was talking? Who was talking there? Listen. Okay, it's God. Wait. Listen. Let me. I'm talking. No, it's a rhetorical question. You know already. So in Isaiah, you know that it's God that was talking. Yeah, it's God that was talking in Isaiah. When you bring the book of Revelation. In Revelation, who wrote the book of Revelation?
Okay, let's go there. Now your argument fails. Why? Because if you're ultimately saying God spoke in Isaiah. But ultimately, your argument would only work if God wrote Isaiah himself. The problem is, you accept it when Isaiah. Stop. I listen to you. Now you know where this is going. Okay. So when Isaiah records the words of God. And Isaiah says that God says, I am the first and last. You accept that, yeah? But that's not written by God, that's written by Isaiah.
Yeah.
So when in Revelation, John writes Revelation and says, Jesus says, I am the first and last, you accept it when Isaiah writes it, one second. But you don't accept it when John writes it.
Let me explain.
For you, it's not about the title. For you, it's about who writes it. But if you want it to be written by God, then you have to reject Isaiah, which you a moment ago just accepted.
Okay, let me respond to that. Okay, so the reason why, you know, sometimes we need to use our analogy to analyze scriptures and quotes. All right. So if in Isaiah God said, "I am the first and I am the last," and then we see in Revelation according to John, Jesus said, "I am the first. Listen, I am the last." Okay. So if I read the same in the New Testament. Okay, in Mark 12, where Jesus is saying that when he was asked, about when one of the rabbi asked him about what is the greatest commandment in the book, what did Jesus answer? Jesus said that the first commandment, love your God. Love your God, Israel, love the Lord your God, and love him with all your heart and all your soul. And then he continued, right? And then he said the second one, love your neighbor, okay? And then the rabbi repeated that, and then to confirm it, he repeated it. He said, yes, you have said the truth, that love your God, and he is the only true God. Listen, he said, he is the only true God. So if we take that analysis, that's a contradiction, because Jesus cannot be... Listen. Jesus cannot be the only true God, and at the same time, God is the only true God. There's only one God.
Can you answer that? You need to go to Exodus. I am. Say, I am sent me.
Okay. So now you're using the argument. Okay. Jesus says the Father is the only true God. Therefore, okay, the Father is the only true God. Therefore, let me speak. Let me speak. Okay. So, my goodness, mate.
So scripture was written by men, but men's book has been carried along by the Holy Spirit.
John, according to Jesus, John said that Jesus said, I am the first and the last. Jesus never uttered from his own mouth, I am the last.
One second. So your argument is that in you're referring to John 17:3, where Jesus says, the Father is the only true God. Therefore, Jesus is not the true God.
Yeah.
The problem is, you're using John's gospel to establish that argument. If you read John's epistle, he also calls Jesus the true God. So John uses that title of the Father and also of the Son. If you read 1 John chapter 5, verse 20, it says these words, and we know that the Son of God, you can't believe that, and we know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding so that we may know the true one. We are in the true one, that is in Jesus Christ. He is the true and eternal God. So that title in John 17:3, the true God to refer to the Father, is also used by John in his epistle. He says that the Son is the eternal true God. So that same title you've just used to the Father, if you accept that and say, therefore, he's the only true God, why don't you accept John elsewhere where he says the Son is the only true God? Now, why can John use that title, the true God, to refer both to the Son and to the Father? Because they share the divine essence. Hebrews chapter 1 verse 3 says that Jesus is the exact imprint of the nature of God. So he shares nature with God. That's why John can use that title of the Son and also the Father. And the title of God is also given to the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 5. All yours.
So what you're telling me is that I should believe that God, there is a one true God, okay? That's one true God. We're going to keep quoting scripture. There's a lot of contradiction in the Bible, you know. We're going to keep quoting scriptures. So, no. Yeah, I have. What I'm saying is that according to your belief now, okay? If I have to understand your belief that Jesus is God, that is the Father, the Son God, the Father God, and the Holy Spirit God. Is that right?
Three in one.
Does that make sense to you?
Yeah.
It makes sense to you?
Yeah. Perfect sense.
Because yeah? That Jesus is not here, the Holy Spirit is here as a governor. The Holy Spirit was sent as a governor.
It was here before?
The Holy Spirit is here permanently.
Permanently?
Yeah, it wasn't here permanently before.
It wasn't here permanently?
No.
So the Holy Spirit wasn't with all the prophets?
It will come on the prophet.
No.
It will come on the prophets and leave.
It's God. How can God come and leave?
When you read the Old Testament, you see... And the word of God came, which is the Holy Spirit. Yeah?
Ultimately, your argument is that there is no plurality in the one being of God, okay? And I'm saying that's simply not true. Even in Genesis, okay? Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, uses the plural term, and then in verse 27, it goes to the singular. Go to Genesis chapter 1,
yeah.
Verse 26. It says, and God said, let us make man in our image. Okay. Genesis 1:26 says that. Okay. We know that we are made in the image of God. Okay. In verse 27, it then goes into the singular, where it says, and he made them in his image. So even, and even, this isn't even foreign to the Jews, okay? There's a Jewish scholar called Dr. Benjamin Sommer, okay? And Dr. Benjamin Sommer writes some works, and he actually references some early Jewish debates, okay? Are you listening?
Yes, I'm listening.
He actually references some early Jewish debates where the Jews, even among themselves, are debating about more than one. The very first Christians were Jews, and yes, they did, because they read the Old Testament. So the very first Jews were the very first Christians were Jews, and they believed in the Trinity. They argued for the Trinity because of the Old Testament, and they saw that Christ fulfills the passages in the Old, in the New.
They saw Christ fulfill everything.
Sorry.
The Jews saw Christ.
The Jews. Yeah. As Dr. Benjamin
So why?
You asked me a question. Yeah. Okay. So even the Jews in the Old Testament. Okay. Even Judaism today. Judaism today is not the Judaism of biblical times. They're two different things. So you shouldn't look at Jews now and think they are the Jews of the Old Testament, because they're not. Okay. The Jews at one second. Okay. Even today, you have many different types of Jews. But there were early debates among the Sadducees and the Pharisees who actually debated whether there's a plurality in the one being of God. That's a fact.
Okay. So explain how about the Council of Nicaea?
The Council of Nicaea.
Yeah.
Okay.
So no, you're laughing because this thing.
Sorry.
Yeah, the thing is that if the Jew believed in the plurality of God.
No, this thing is Nicaea. You said Nicaea.
Yeah. No, I'm making a point. I'm trying to make a point. If the Jews believed in the Trinity, yeah, and then it was all the way there, the Trinity sends Jesus. If Jesus Christ really taught Trinity and the disciples of Jesus believe the Trinity. Okay?
So what's your language?
So why would there be so much discussion?
So basically you're saying that if the Trinity was taught very early on, then why Nicaea?
Yeah, Christianity.
Okay, JC, is that still rolling? It's still rolling. Okay, so let me respond to that. At Nicaea, okay, let me ask you one question just to see if you actually understand anything about Nicaea.
Yeah.
Do you know how many canons are in Nicaea?
How many canons? I've read the history, okay?
Okay.
I didn't count the canon. Listen. Let me answer to you.
Quickly.
Listen. I read it. I'm not a Christian, okay?
I know.
I followed the Christian history, okay?
No, you don't.
Listen. And I know that there was a council, there was a couple councils. But the Council of Nicaea, when Constantine the Great, when he became Christian, okay? When he became Christian, but most of the Christians knew that he wasn't a Christian. Actually, he was a pagan, okay? And then he ordered the Council of Nicaea, okay, of Constantinople. And then, so I might be wrong in the history.
You are wrong, yeah. You are wrong.
But the point I'm trying to make is that the Christian on that day, there was a lot of different groups of Christians.
Can I answer
Some
this?
Believe
can
in
I,
the Unitarian.
Can
Listen,
I answer this?
There was a Unitarian Christian. There were Unitarian Christians, and there were other Christians that believed in the concept of Trinity.
Can I answer
and
this?
So they had the meeting to have a clear.
Listen, can I respond? Can I respond?
Yeah, go on.
Okay, don't interrupt. I listen to you.
But I didn't finish.
Please, you're going on for a while. Listen to the answer. Okay, so the Council of Nicaea, first and foremost. So the Council of Nicaea, first and foremost, okay, was not about establishing the doctrine of the Trinity. The Council of Nicaea came about because there was a heretic called Arius, okay, who was preaching that Jesus was not of the same nature as the Father in the fullest sense. He believed he was. One second.
So there was a conflict already.
Stop. Just let me speak. Okay.
Yeah,
let me
speak.
So Arius, okay, didn't believe Jesus was eternally God. Okay. So listen. So why did this debate happen? This debate happens because they was going to refute and reject. Can we move back a bit? I can't hear myself. Sorry, yeah, I couldn't hear myself think. So the Council of Nicaea in 325 AD, that's when it happened, 325 AD, okay? The Council of Nicaea happened because there was a man called Arius who come up, okay, and he was preaching heresy. So what happened at church councils, they come together, there was a couple of thousand bishops invited to this council. but around 318 or something like that actually turned up to debate this subject, okay? And Arius, okay, are you listening?
Yeah, I'm listening.
Arius, okay, Arius was condemned as a heretic, not because they sat down and said, right, okay, guys, we need to figure this out. We need to see if the Bible does teach the doctrine of the Trinity. No, because they believed in the doctrine of the Trinity well before Nicaea. I can show you church fathers' writings I have on my phone that talk about the Trinity 1 second before Nicaea. So Nicaea, no, 1 second, I'm answering your question. So Nicaea came about to refute heresy, not to establish a doctrine.
Okay.
No, one second. And the reason why I asked you, okay,
yeah,
how many canons are in Nicaea? I've read the canons of Nicaea.
Yeah.
I know what was being discussed at Nicaea.
Yeah.
You saying that the doctrine of the Trinity was established at Nicaea demonstrates to me you don't actually know what Nicaea was about. That's why I asked you.
Yeah.
That's why I asked you how many canons are in Nicaea, and you said I don't know.
Yeah,
That's what I'm saying. All due respect.
But you won't lie to me.
All due respect.
Yeah.
You've got to stop listening to what I'm. One second. Let me. Stop talking. Listen.
Yeah.
You've got to stop listening to what other people tell you and read the primary sources. Because if you read Nicaea, then you will understand what Nicaea was about. It wasn't about establishing the canon. It wasn't about establishing the Trinity. The Trinity was already believed and was spoken of by Irenaeus, Ignatius, Clement of Rome, Polycarp, all of these people who come well over 100 years before Nicaea.
Okay, my point is that during the early Christianity, that was a lot of group. That was my point, all right?
Tell me some.
They believe in different.
Tell me some.
Like the one you say, the...
Arius. And what happened? Arius was a minority. He was a heretic. 1 second. He was a heretic. In fact, do you know what happened at Nicaea?
I was listening to you.
Do you know what happened at Nicaea?
You know what I mean?
Okay.
You want to talk again?
There was a bishop, okay? Because you're trying to have this view that there was all these different kinds of Christianities. I'm saying no, there wasn't. Arius was so outraged the other bishops that actually Saint Nicholas, yeah, who was a bishop, stood up at Nicaea. He walked across the room and he slapped Arius across the face because he found his heresy offensive.
Explain in a clear manner.
Okay, the
true belief of Arius.
Okay. Because
he read the scripture. Listen, no, I want to make my question clear because Arius read the scripture.
Arius, sorry, maybe I pronounced it wrong.
He read the scripture and then he had different understanding of the scripture. So what was his understanding of the scripture?
His understanding.
So basically,
Arius come to the conclusion that Jesus wasn't fully, Jesus wasn't eternally God.
Okay. Cool.
Let me finish my answer.
Actually, you've answered. No, I haven't answered. No, you've answered.
I've only part answered. Let me finish
you've
the answer.
Arius believe that Jesus let
me finish my answer.
Fully God.
Let me finish my answer. Let me finish my answer.
Yeah, go on.
Okay. So yes, Arius did not believe Jesus was fully eternally. 1 second.
Arius didn't believe.
Have a conversation. Stop. He didn't believe. He didn't believe Jesus was eternally God, okay? That's why the council come together, because he was...
Okay, I don't know if you listen to yourself. So if there's a conflict...
I wish you would listen to me.
I listened to you for like half an hour, so... You don't say I listen to you. So Arius believes that... He read the scripture, he understood something else. So if God the Almighty, his word is so clear in the Bible, his word is so profound and clear, and there is no contradiction, why will Arius understood that Jesus Christ is not fully divine? Why will he believe that? And the other Christian, they believe that Jesus was divine. Why is that contradiction?
Can I answer?
Listen.
Can I answer?
Listen.
Are you interested in truth and learning and moving forward, or just arguing and hearing?
I'm not arguing. Are you interested in finding the truth? Are you?
Let me stand back.
Can I answer?
Okay, listen to me.
Can I answer?
If you,
my friends, can I answer your question? Okay, yes, Arius did read the... And ultimately, actually, you're kind of wrong. You are kind of wrong. Because Arius didn't come to this position through entirely reading the scripture and saying that's what the scripture says.
But he was a Christian.
1 second, stop.
He used
stop.
The Bible.
Just stop.
As his divine
just stop. 1 second.
No,
just stop. I am telling you to stop.
Just relax.
Just relax.
Just relax. Understanding, brother.
Listen. Okay, listen. Arius.
You cannot force me to like accept.
I'm not saying you are, but I'm not asking you. I'm not asking you to accept what I say. I'm asking you just to listen.
But I listen to half an hour. So when I'm talking,
you've made a point. Let me respond. Just stop talking for 2 seconds. Okay. So Arius, you are wrong. Arius didn't come to this conclusion simply through reading the scripture. It was actually more of a philosophical argument. But what did the 1 second?
That's your own interpretation.
This is a fact of history. You haven't even read Nicaea, and you're telling me this is just my opinion. 1 second. So what did the early church at Nicaea argue from? They argued one from scripture and also apostolic tradition. Okay. What does scripture teach? Scripture teaches Jesus is eternally God. What did the apostles hand down to us? That Jesus is eternally God. Arius rejected that. That's why he was condemned as a heretic. Now, if you're arguing that, well, you have a heretic there, therefore the scripture is not that clear, you have heretics in your own faith. I don't then say to you, because you have
heretics... Show me one heretic that disagrees with the Quran.
I'm Ahmadiyya. Ahmadiyyas. Ahmadiyyas. See. So Ahmadiyyas, if I'm pronouncing that right, okay, they have a different interpretation of Christ, basically, okay? They believe he's already come back in the form of the gentleman who came some years ago, yeah? The Ahmadiyyas, okay? Now, you would say they're wrong. They read the scripture and interpreted it differently to you. But does it therefore mean the Quran's not true?
That where in the Quran they talk that? Are you aware?
One second.
The Quran is here. Show me where Ahmadiyya understood that Jesus has already come. Where?
Okay, so who they believe is the Messiah already come, yes?
Show me where.
Okay, Google Ahmadiyyas. I don't have to show you. It's a well-known fact. It's a well-known fact. Who's a Muslim here? Are you guys Muslims? Are you Muslim? The Ahmadiyyas. You'd agree they're heretics, yes? Thank you. So just because they're heretics among the early...
No, what I'm saying is that they're heretics doesn't nullify the whole faith. If they use the Quran as their base
No. That's not my argument. That's not my argument.
But what I'm saying is that...
This is painful.
No, bro. You're talking. We are talking. I have the right to talk as well. Do you know what I mean?
But I'm correcting you on... But you're telling me... You are telling me, okay, that the Ahmadiyyas argue this from the Quran. I haven't said that.
Okay,
I'm saying, just stop talking.
Because my base is the Quran.
Stop talking. One second.
Whatever the
One second. Let's not change subject. What I'm saying is this. Is that as the Ahmadiyyas, okay, may have a philosophical argument they're arguing from. Thank you. To prove that the Messiah has already come. You're saying rightly, we're going to the Quran to establish that they're wrong. I'm saying yes, you should do that. But I'm saying that's what the Council of Nicaea done. They argued from the Bible to disprove Arius. They also argued from apostolic tradition, which was handed down to the church. So they are arguing not philosophically, but through scripture and tradition.
The thing is that, let's look at the context of discussion right here, all right? We are talking about Jesus Christ. Now you have to listen to me.
I've not said a word.
Okay, let's...
I'm listening.
Well, okay, cool. Your body language says something. So, we are talking about the divinity of Jesus Christ, which is the fundamental pillars of your belief, okay? Yeah? You understand? Which is the fundamental pillar of your belief. If Jesus Christ is not the Lord, is not the Son of God, your belief is in vain, right? If I'm wrong, just tell me I'm wrong.
Yeah, if Jesus is not God, then my faith is nullified.
Yeah, then if Jesus is not divine, then your faith is...
He's resurrected.
Yeah.
Also the divinity too.
Yeah,
if he's not
divine... You know what I mean? It's not about... You know what I'm saying? Hey, Jesus Christ is not, it's not the Son of God. If he's not divine, then your faith is in vain. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's what the Council of Nicaea was, let's say, partly about. All right?
Listen, all due respect, we've established you don't know what the canons of Nicaea say. You don't know what Nicaea was about.
He was a Unitarian.
You couldn't tell me how many bishops were at Nicaea.
He wasn't there.
Arius.
Yeah, he wasn't.
Okay, listen to me.
He didn't attend the council.
That's a claim.
Okay, everything you've said about Nicaea, all due respect, is wrong. You don't know anything about Nicaea. Okay, listen to me. All due respect, Nicaea, as I've already said, was not about establishing any doctrine of the Trinity, any canon of scripture, or anything like that. There was a heretic who arose called Arius. The church met together to stamp out this heresy. And as I've already said, it wasn't a case of, well, guys, Arius has this opinion. We have this opinion. Let's argue to see which one of our opinions is true. No, they already rejected Arius' opinion because they deemed it as heretical. And it was so heretical, so offensive, that St. Nicholas, who was a bishop, smacked a heretic across the face for holding to the Arian heresy. This wasn't a case of, well, this is one form of Christianity, this is another, let's meet to decide which one we should follow. They met to condemn this heretic. That's how the church, throughout the early church, has always gathered to discuss heresies, okay? You have Nicaea to establish the establish the Arians as heretics, okay? You have councils and meetings about Nestorianism, okay, monothelitism. All of these different heresies, they come to meet as councils because they hear that some bishop somewhere or someone is preaching heresy, so they meet together as a collective group, okay? And where do they get this from? They get this from Acts chapter 15, because Acts chapter 15, there was a discussion going around about whether the Christians need to be circumcised first to become a Christian, okay? The Jerusalem Council, Acts 15, met together to establish what needs to be done, what we believe, what is heresy, okay? And Nicaea simply followed suit. So Nicaea did not meet to establish a doctrine, they met to affirm a doctrine and to condemn a heretic. So all due respect, you don't know about Nicaea, please don't pretend you do.
No, I'm not pretending I do, what I'm saying is...
You did? You made an argument from Nicaea?
Yeah, I made an argument because that's what...
And now you admit you don't know about Nicaea.
That's what history is saying, all right? That's what history is saying. What you are saying is that maybe that's your own interpretation of the history. That's what be your own interpretation of the
I've
history.
Read Nicaea, you haven't.
All right?
I've read Nicaea, you haven't.
But Nicaea can be part of different stuff.
Like what? What do you mean by that?
Like what you just explained, but at the same time, they confirm the divinity of Jesus Christ, which the heretic, the guy called the heretic,
Arius.
Yeah, Arius, didn't believe, but they reconfirm it, right?
Sorry.
So the divinity of Jesus Christ was discussed.
Okay, so hold on. We have to be careful with language. You said they reconfirmed it. Reconfirming something kind of presupposes that it was that it was lost and now they're reconfirming it. It was never lost. They met to affirm what they already believed. And as I said, as I said earlier, I can show you.
That's what I'm saying. He believed, Arius believed that Jesus wasn't fully divine.
One second, right? Let me answer. No, he didn't. Listen. He didn't just get that.
That's the base of Christianity.
See, if you want, if you understand,
that means that Jesus Christ is divine.
Listen.
Arius rejected that, right?
To that particular claim.
Okay, listen.
And
okay,
he rejected
okay.
That.
Your argument is, as we've already gone through this, that Arius.
Yeah, that's the problem.
Let me answer the question. That Arius simply got this from reading the scripture. He did, but it wasn't all he got this from. It was more of a philosophical argument that he got this. Let me speak, sir. It was more of a philosophical argument that he was using, okay? Now, as I said, what did the church do? They went to scripture and apostolic succession, apostolic tradition to establish the teaching of the Trinity. And I can show you right now, if you're trying to argue the Trinity or the deity of Christ only came about at 325 AD at the Council of Nicaea, I can show you from early church fathers that I have on my phone that they explicitly talk about the doctrine of the Trinity over 100 years before Nicaea. Irenaeus, Ignatius, many other people, Polycarp, I can show you that. So if I can show you that, your argument is false.
No, stop. Listen, whatever you're sure about, these people, they are Christian, right?
Who?
Well, these people you just...
Arius? Arius. No.
Those people that you just... I don't know them by name.
Arius was not a Christian.
No.
He was a heretic.
Okay, whatever you call him, that's fine. I accept that, all right? But what I'm saying is that those other group of people that believe in the divinity of Jesus, yeah, they were Christian. They read the Bible, all right? And they came up with this understanding, all right? They read the same Bible and they understood that, all right? And then Arius read the same Bible and then he understood something else. That's what my base is. That Arius.
I've already answered you.
Yeah. I know. But I don't know how to explain this. Like Jesus, like
fair
Jesus,
enough.
Like the disciples, did they believe in the divinity of Jesus Christ?
Yes, I did. Yeah.
All right.
Yes. Would you like me to show you where?
No, because that's the early.
Let me show you where.
The early source, because all those people that you had to, they came like 100 or 200 years.
Okay, the early source. Matthew chapter 2.
Because John was written like 70 years after.
Can I speak? Can I speak? Okay. So Matthew chapter 2, Jesus is worshipped. In Luke, Jesus is worshipped. In John 20:28, Jesus is called Lord and God. In many other places in the Bible, Jesus is worshipped. He receives worship. In Revelation, he's called the Alpha and the Omega. All of these are divine titles and divine claims that Christ himself makes. So yes, the early church fathers believed in the divinity of Christ. The gospel itself, the gospels and the New Testament epistles, all claim that Jesus is divine and he is God in flesh. Okay, all of them say that. But to be honest, I think maybe we should close this because we're kind of going over the same stuff. All I would say to you.
2, 5, and 6, you must have the same attitude that Jesus Christ had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. John 3:17-21, that they may all be one, as though Father and I are one, and I in thee.
One second.
So the disciples, all of them, they are God.
Can listen. All due respect, let's wrap this up. All due respect, let me just say one thing. I'll close with this, okay?
No, I'll close it.
Listen, you can have. I'll tell you what. You have your last word.
Yeah,
I'll have my last word. Go ahead.
Okay.
The floor is yours, sir.
Yeah. So basically, this discussion has been going on for thousands and thousands of years, and even during the early Christians, they had confusion over the scripture among themselves, as we just discussed. This gentleman here, he's a Christian. I respect his knowledge. He got a lot of knowledge, more than me, I admit it, in the Bible, because obviously he's a Christian, all right? But me, as a Muslim, if I read the scripture, and then what I understand, and according to history and everything, and the true teachings of Jesus Christ, even in the Bible, what I understand, what Jesus Christ is clearly saying, my God and your God, what Jesus Christ is clearly saying in Mark 19, that the first of all commandments is, hear, O Israel, your God, your Lord is one. And then he agreed with the rabbi that confirmed that, because the Jews before that, they didn't believe in the Trinity. They believed that there was one Yahweh, there was one God, which all of the Jews believed in. So the reason why I believe that the Jews didn't respect or didn't accept it, or a bulk of them didn't accept Jesus Christ, because they were expecting a king, a Messiah, and someone that is powerful, that is sent by God, you know what I mean? And then he came, and then they didn't see this character in Jesus Christ, and then he was killed. He was killed by the Jews themselves. So the Jews, obviously, they won't believe in him, because they believe that if the Messiah comes, the man of God, no one can kill him and crucify him and torture him as they did. So as for that, we believe that Jesus Christ is the Messiah. As a Muslim, is the Messiah, is one of the mightiest messengers. We believe in all his prophecy. We believe that he will come back, and we believe that when he comes back, as the scripture says, he will say to the Christian, go away from me, I didn't need you, I didn't teach that you should do miracles in my name, but you should worship with the one true God. As Moses, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, David, Solomon, all the prophets, they believe in the one true God. So my brother and sister,
thank you.
So this is the discussion.
Can you begin in the closing with explaining why the Jews didn't see the character of the Messiah that they were expecting in Jesus Christ, and how Jesus Christ came,
so you need to
and why
teach
they
him.
Missed
you, him? You need to teach
no,
him what
no.
to say.
No, I'm
Is this still rolling? It's still going, yeah?
Yeah, it's just
okay, okay.
Yeah, sorry about that.
Okay, so yeah, okay, so the system, okay, so, this, okay, so. Listen, listen, all due respect, I didn't interrupt you when you was doing that. Have some respect, please, okay. So, the gentleman, what's your name?
Amara
made many claims that I disagree with. One of the claims he just made was that the Jews rejected the Messiah would die, okay? And that's a blanket statement, that's simply not true. Because the first Christians were Jews who believed the Messiah died. If you read Isaiah 53, it's a messianic prophecy that is actually talking about crucifixion. It says the hands and feet will be pierced, okay? Who did this happen to? Who was this fulfilled in Jesus Christ? And not only that, but Isaiah 53 is so clear and explicit in this prophecy that it even prophesies the man who was to bury Christ. It says that a rich man will be with him in his death. And in Matthew's gospel, we see that it was Joseph of Arimathea who is said to be a rich man who buried Christ. So the Jews, in contradiction to what you said, actually recognize this is the Messiah. He did die on the cross, and we should accept him as he has been revealed to us, not as we would like him to be, okay? The man also brought up the Council of Nicaea. I think we've established he doesn't actually know what the Council of Nicaea is all about. I asked him, have you read the canons of Nicaea? He didn't know what the canons of Nicaea were. He doesn't know how many canons there were. And ultimately, whenever these church councils gather together, it was to refute heresy. Have some respect. It was to refute heresy. Okay? So Nicaea done this, to refute Arianism. It wasn't because they thought Arius might be correct. They met there to condemn the heresy, to stamp out the teaching, and to affirm what they was already teaching. Irenaeus, Ignatius, Polycarp, Clement of Rome, all of these people refer to the doctrine of the Trinity in their own writings. This is before Nicaea. So to say that the Trinity came about at Nicaea is simply wrong. And I think he gets this argument probably from Google or YouTube, which is why I say we shouldn't do that. Don't simply listen to what I'm telling you. Don't simply listen to what somebody else tells you. Read the primary sources. Because if you read Nicaea, you'll recognize what Amaro said is nonsense. God bless.
Thanks.
I did say your name, but Amaro?
Yeah, Amaro, you missed
something like that.
Sorry.
Was that recorded? Was it?
Yeah, of course not. This was his.
So I would just like to explain something that Amaro raised, and he did have a point in it, in which he stated that the Jews didn't reject Jesus Christ. And it is true, some Jews did reject Jesus Christ. And the reason why they rejected him was because they were under oppression from the Romans. And they expected a Messiah to come with like the equivalent of like machine guns and just defeat the Romans. But that's not why he came. He came in love. He came with a message of simplicity, of repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. He came to die for our sins. He came to die for the entire world. So that's why some of the Jews missed him, because they were expecting an army to come and defeat the mighty Romans. And he didn't come to war with man. He didn't come for judgment at the first coming. That his first coming was to redeem us from our sins and to bring us back into the kingdom that was lost through Adam and Eve. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sis Hagata. Praise the Lord.
We are a free channel, bro. So free speech channel. So don't make it too long, though.
No.
So this will be your second wrap-up, basically.
Yeah, second wrap-up.
All right, cool. Yeah. Well,
yeah.
Go ahead, bro.
Yeah.
Right, action.
Yeah, so basically, what I'm trying to say is that the Muslims, we believe that Jesus Christ, I've already said that, I'm just going to repeat that again. We believe that Jesus Christ, is the mightiest prophet. And then the reason why he will come back on this earth, he's not going to pay the cost. The reason why he's coming back is to clarify everything, all this misconception that's going on. This is some of the wisdom of God that he took him back. Do you know what I mean? So So when he comes back, everything will be clear, everything will be understood, and we will see that he was a Muslim. We will see that he followed Abraham, the religion of Abraham. He followed the religion of Moses. He followed the religion of all the truth prophets of God, of his creator, you know? And then all the misconception about the Council of Nicaea, all this creed that went on. Because if there was a one true message, a clear message in the Bible from the beginning, from the day one, then there wouldn't be a Unitarian Christian and all these other ideologies, you know what I mean? So we believe that Jesus Christ taught to believe in one true God, the one true God. As he said, he's great to his God and your God. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, bro.